Good day. My name is Eric Huck. I'm the president of the Harrisburg Area Lyme Disease Support Group and a co-founder of Pennsylvania Lyme. We have today an excellent lineup. It's a chock-full day that's going to be full of call-in speakers. We have, who will be calling in with us later, Dr. Harold Smith, medical doctor out of Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania. 40-year background, he is one of the few Lyme-literate medical doctors in Pennsylvania. Also joining us later is going to be Senator Stewart Greenleaf, who is the sponsor of Act 177, which became, or Senate Bill 177, which became Act 83, which is the Lyme Prevention, Education, and Surveillance Act. What we wanted to do with today's show was really just give an overview of Lyme disease in America, how it relates to individuals that have Lyme and their families. We'll talk a little bit of the growth in Pennsylvania of the Volunteer Support Grassroots Network. With me today is Anne Desjardins, who is the 17th regional leader who's going to be starting the Berks County Lyme Support Group, actually starting next month. We wanted to use this opportunity to really let this be a showcase for some of the Lyme information and facts as it relates here in the Berks County area. And I want to thank you very much for really creating this opportunity for us to be able to do this.
Yes. Thank you for supporting me.
Yeah, well, it's our pleasure, totally. You know, you and I, actually, this is the first that we've had an opportunity to meet. I know we have spent an awful lot of time on the phone together, working and coordinating. I'm actually really curious, kind of a little bit of your background professionally and kind of how your background lent itself to wanting to start a Lyme support group here in the area.
Sure. So a little bit about me. I do work locally here for a company called Graphica, and I work for them in their sales department. We specialize in retail packaging. And so I think throughout my career, sales has always been something that's been near and dear to my heart. So that only led to catapulting me into stepping up here with Lyme disease. I was diagnosed with this in August, just of this past summer, but I suffered for 6 to 7 years before finding an accurate diagnosis for what was wrong with me. I struggled through that 6 years mostly in silence because I supposedly had nothing wrong with me. Doctors kept saying there was nothing wrong with me. Maybe I was too stressed. Maybe at one point they did diagnose me with narcolepsy, which I knew that wasn't correct either. But I just felt very much so alone. I have great family and friends and support that way, but because I couldn't really talk to anyone about this, I felt very alone, and I just don't want anyone else to have to go through that themselves. So that is another reason why I particularly have decided to go about starting this group. I find a lot of relief once I'm able to share with people about my story and the struggles that I've gone through myself with this. So I think with sales and just my personal background, I'm related to a lot of physicians. I have a pretty good connection with the medical community and a pretty good understanding of how it works. So I think all of that in conjunction with just being diagnosed, it makes a lot of sense for me to step up and do this.
It's the right time. It's a perfect time to be doing it. I think what you'll learn by watching this show is that individuals that either have Lyme themselves or they have a family member, a child that have Lyme, because of the controversy of Lyme, because of the challenges in finding proper diagnosis, in finding a medical doctor that'll treat appropriately, Lyme is controversial in that it's very common for individuals to really go to a lot of doctors before they finally find somebody that's going to actually be able to help them and work towards getting better. My personal Lyme story was I was hiking the Appalachian Trail in 2009. 2 days later, I was watching television and I noticed I had an engorged tick in the back of my knee, and I noticed that I had an engorged tick in my groin area also. So the two ticks had been in me for longer than 48 hours. It really freaked me out. I took them out inappropriately. You will learn by staying tuned to the rest of the show proper ways, what to do if you get bit by a tick and proper ways of removing a tick. But what I did improperly was try to burn it out and tug it out with pliers. I got very, very sick about 4 months later, to the degree where I was just sick for three straight years. I had found a competent Lyme literate doctor in Maryland, but after 3 years of antibiotics, I really wasn't getting that much better. What I chose to do was look at alternative protocols, alternative treatments, and I ended up going to Germany for a month. And what I found was that there are protocols that they do in Europe and elsewhere that are really not approved here in Pennsylvania. That jumpstarted me tremendously. When I came back, that really gave me the initiative to try to, much like you, operate in my local community to help others to make sure that nobody else went through the same thing. So I was very, very fortunate to be affiliated with a local support group started by Linda Ollie in the Harrisburg area. And after about a year, Linda's health was not allowing her to really take on and keep management of the support group, so I ended up taking over. Pennsylvania Lyme Resource really grew out of the effort of about four or five different individuals. Julia Wagner, who you'll hear a little bit about through some of the leanings from Senator Greenleaf, she started Lyme Action PA, and she was very vocal in starting Montgomery County Lyme and then Lyme Action PA. And what she recognized by her children having Lyme and herself having Lyme, there wasn't much of a conversation happening legislatively, so she did what you and I did, started a support group, and then she started really working with Senator Greenleaf to try to move legislation here in Pennsylvania. So through her efforts, the efforts of other individuals, and certainly through wanting to figure out how can we create a support group that will support other local support groups. That happened in 2012. So Pennsylvania Lyme's formation was 2012. And since then, I'm really very proud to say we have made a lot of inroads into Lyme disease here in Pennsylvania. Not only have we held five medical conferences with in conjunction with ILADS, which is the International Lyme and Associated Diseases Society, we've held them in Pennsylvania local, Philadelphia and Hershey, where we've invited as many as 100 doctors to spend 2-3 days in getting educated on Lyme and tick-borne diseases. Pennsylvania Lyme also has run patient conferences. We have done a lot of work legislatively, and I'm very proud to say that you will be the 17th support group that is starting. I was on the phone yesterday with an individual just very much like you who will probably be starting a Lyme support group in Butler County. So it's a grassroots effort, and it's definitely growing. So with that as a little bit of a backdrop, what I would like to do is, let's go to the slide if we can. I want to give the viewing audience the opportunity to see the support group that you'll be starting and some of the particulars.
Awesome. So I, again, was very moved to start the support group. I feel that it's very important for Berks County to have a resource at their fingertips to be able to at least get some guidance, get some support, have some individuals to really understand the pain and the troubles that they're going through. So my first meeting is going to be Wednesday, March 21st at 6 p.m. Approximate end time is 8 p.m., but we'll be showing Under Our Skin, and that's going to be held at the Atonement Lutheran Church in Wyomissing. So that would be at the intersection of Penn Avenue and State Hill Road. And I also found, I was a little bit surprised when I started to research support groups in our area, that we don't actually have one here in Berks County. We are one of the highest rates of infection in this state, let alone probably the entire country. And I just feel that this is something that would really benefit to have around to get, again, because it is so controversial, you can't really Google to find doctors that are going to be willing to treat you at this point in time. So it is sort of word of mouth. Sadly, that has to be such, but I'm way happy to be a resource to be able to get people in touch with the help that they need.
Gotcha. And as you notice that we'll be showing Under Our Skin, which is a documentary that was done about Lyme disease. What we have found is that the particular way that a support group is started, that the showing of Under Our Skin, we're going to try to have a Lyme literate medical doctor there to take questions afterwards. We have had some regions, Lehigh Valley Lyme, this is how they started. They had 100 people that came out of the woodwork. We have been told if you build this, the people are going to come out of the woodwork. And that is absolutely what we have found, that because of the controversy, because of individuals not really being able to get proper care all the time, just having a support group, having a connection to the local community is really very, very important. So what I'd like to do is introduce our first guest speaker, and that is Dr. Harold Smith. I'll give a little bit of his background, if it's okay. Do we have him on the line?
Yes, I'm here, Eric.
Harold, allow me, I want to thank you. I know you very well. I've had a great opportunity working with you in the past, but I learned some information that I wasn't aware of. So allow me to give just a proper introduction that you went to the Duke University School of Medicine, class of 1970, your postgraduate residency training in surgery, pathology, and emergency medicine, that you've been doing a clinical practice here in Pennsylvania for 40 years. I did not realize that you practiced and directed emergency care for 25 years. I know that your practice up in Bloomsburg has been around for about 16 years. What I didn't know, Dr. Smith, was that you were a founding member of ILADS and that the first meeting actually was in Sunbury. That's phenomenal. I mean, you've been at the grassroots of an infectious disease that really science and medicine and doctors and insurance companies don't quite have a handle on yet. I want to thank you very much because you are also on the Pennsylvania Governor's Task Force for Lyme Disease, Act 83, and you're a medical advisor to Pennsylvania Lyme. So you bring a lot to the table for Lyme patients. Thank you very much for being on with us today.
Yes.
So what I would like to start off with is there is just simply a ton of disagreement about Lyme disease, the definition, how you diagnose, how you treat, what the protocols are. You see it every day. Why do you believe it's so controversial?
There are different entities who have different definitions, because they have different purposes and goals with the definition. I mean, this isn't a judgmental statement that someone is wrong or one entity, but for example, the public health system has a goal of counting specifically a definition of tick-borne infections that's very solid, has visible evidence, can be used to follow trends in the state. So that definition is going to be very specific with objective findings, such as a certain type rash, a certain heart rhythm, a certain nerve weakness in the face called Bell's palsy, a swollen knee. Those are all very direct, observed facts of a group of patients. So we can always say in public health, gosh, Pennsylvania is getting more or they're getting fewer cases now that we're doing certain interventions. Of course, medical insurance has a goal of when do they have to pay for an illness that sometimes is quite broad, could be something else. Research is going to have a different definition. For example, developing a vaccine for Lyme disease was developed around just one germ. There are other germs in ticks. And then finally, there's the doctor-patient relationship that uses a definition very much along the Act 83, advice and education to patients. And that's much broader. There may be no safe time that a tick can feed on you. There's different germs. a Rocky Mountain spotted fever, transmission is fairly quick. The Borrelia burgdorf Lyme germ, well, the longer that tick feeds, the more germ is introduced. But at one day in animals, there's still a 15% transmission of disease. The only rule about 3 days was in the past, well, that's 100% transmission. You know, and so likewise, testing, public health, you know, could use very specific criteria that they defined for a positive test. Yet in an office working with patients, those criteria could be much broader based on the office experience with patients. You know, I think when you mentioned then there's a controversy, well, what happens is there's potential problems that arise when one definition for one area, such as public health, you might say is forced into another realm, which would be in the doctor's office. Because public health is not, you know, taking on a responsibility of treating patients and weighing the risk versus the benefit of treating a patient. So I think that that's where the controversy occurs, is, you know, trying to force a doctor-patient definition in an office. Why isn't public health counting all these? Well, sometimes we don't even know for sure it's tick-borne infections until the person starts to get better. You know? And, you know, in the physician practice, you know, we're always weighing, is there more benefit? And we drop the no harm. Is there more benefit and less harm, you know, in deciding to pursue this illness? And I think finally, all of us, all the different realms, public health, research, doctor's offices, disability, health insurance, you know, what we're all suffering from is there is not available to us testing that actually shows the germs. You know, everyone is thinking that, oh, it's like a strep throat culture, there's the germ, or a urine culture, there's the germ. No, what's offered to the public is, oh, there's your immune system reacting to a germ in a commercial test kit or laboratory. You know, it's an immune system test. It's not the germ. So it's very difficult to actually count the cases based on the germ or see that a treatment is working better now. You described that you went to Germany and had a very, you know, developed and broader treatment program that may be able to be developed better if we could actually show the germs and now there's less germs. And how about if we could show now there's no germ? So, you know, I think that that's one direction to answer definitions would be let's base it on a direct test of the germ.
Well, I certainly know getting a better test is, you know, our community is vocal that the current tests are just inadequate, and that's very clear. You mentioned a good point about ticks carrying multiple different diseases. I know in my case, and that's why I got so sick, that I was diagnosed with 6 co-infections, the Bartonella, Babesia, Ehrlichia, Anaplasmosis, Protomyxoa rheumatica, that not only did I just have Lyme, the Borrelia, I also had 5 of the other co-infectors, separate diseases, which it was a cat and mouse game for years and years and years and years for me to get better. But that's the question that I have for you. With such a complex disease, how do you work with patients that have that? What's your experience with working with patients, going through that process, and getting them on a path to getting better? How has that worked for you?
There are two different situations, you know, we could say two different general protocols available. One would be for the patient who was just exposed, just had a tick bite, or is in an area or lifestyle with tick exposures and just had a typical flu-like picture but without the sore throat or diarrhea, and you know, that flu just kept going on and on and on. You know, that would be kind of the acute or new onset that we would have an approach to. And then there would be the later stage where this might be after 6 months, it might be after several accumulated bites in Pennsylvania. Doesn't have to just be one bite, does it? It could be an accumulation over time, and the person usually has been sick now for 6 months or more, and in this persistent stage of illness, now there are what we call systemic effects complicating your getting better. This group of germs, as parasites, can start interfering with your night-day rhythms, how sleep restored you. Can interfere with energy production. It takes energy to fight germs, and these germs can interfere with the amount of energy you can produce. They can interfere with immune responses. You know, they can interfere with the stimulus response in a human or other animal in Pennsylvania because they're parasites, and that's what they do to control the population. I mean, ticks are predators, and they have to control the population that they're exposed to, and they do this by interfering with stimulus responses. So in the first case, I just got bit. The germs are spreading in me, but my entire military is not compromised. I'm ready, you know, to fight with good sleep, restoration, hormones, immune system, energy. So that may be fairly simple with, you know, a group of antibiotics, oral, just swallowing them, that would kind of cover what you could get in a way. Because, you know, the individual germs that you got, Eric, they often don't signal anything specific. There are some things, such as a Bartonella or a cat scratch might give a certain skin rash, scratch look, or Babesia, a malaria-like germ, may more often give night sweats and then shaking chills and high agitation. But all the groups of germs there, after a while, all give fatigue and different kinds of pain and interruption of nervous system responses. So, you know, later on, we're going to have a broader protocol, not only addressing the antibiotics for what you could get, but also addressing the spin-off effects, you know, that might be in sleep or immune system or hormones or even supplements that we need or lack. And I think that's what you described in your case, was there are patients that these systems could be associated with the germs or caused by them, and that you have to reach out, you know, further to get the human or, you know, to reset their systems. So I think there are protocols, but they're going to be fairly broad concepts. You know, the longer you've had it, the longer you're going to use antibiotics. The longer you've had it, the more you're going to need assistance, perhaps in sleep or eating properly to generate energy. Or you may be deficient in very important supplements in Pennsylvania. They're almost like an antidote in Pennsylvania, so many of us are deficient. When I call hormone D, because it's really a hormone, it's called a vitamin, and many of us are deficient in selenium and iodine and omega-3 fish oils. These are very fundamental to add, you know, to our program. So I think the longer we've had it, such as what you're describing yourself, often the a broader, more investigative process is involved. Did that help?
Yes, thank you.
I think, and I would have to agree with you. In my unmedical opinion, I sort of feel that as being having it for as long as I did, just to get some clarity, then I was needing to be on herbal supplements. I'm on now for 3 months, but I'm suspecting it'll be quite some time until then. But
Dr. Smith, I want to thank you very, very much for taking time and participating with us. I think we're going to have other opportunities in the future to be doing this. And with your role as a medical advisor to Pennsylvania Lyme, and certainly your role and influence on the governor's task force is really, we need it and we appreciate that. And it actually kind of segues into our next caller. We have also on the phone with us Senator Stewart Greenleaf. And he has a special place in everybody's heart. Certainly, if they have Lyme disease or if it's in their family, Senator Greenleaf has been representing Montgomery and Bucks County, Pennsylvania's 12th district, since 1978. Formerly, he was with the House of Representatives here in Pennsylvania. Currently, Senator Greenleaf, he's the chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, former vice chair of the Senate Intergovernmental Operations Committee. As I looked at Senator Greenleaf, I know you're on the phone with us, as I looked at your background, I was pretty impressed with the high degree of legislation and the significant amount of legislation that you authored. I've known you now for probably, 7-8 years now, back in the day before Senate Bill 177. And I know that Julia Wagner with Lyme Action PA, really one of your constituents that went to you to try to get Lyme legislation, and you just kept plugging away, and Senate Bill 177 becoming Act 83. So we want to really just thank you very much for joining us today.
It's my pleasure, and I don't have a lot of good qualities, but one quality I do have is perseverance. So we've been plugging away at this, and with Julia, and we appreciate your support and help on this to educate the public that we're involved in a middle of an epidemic of a disease known as Lyme disease. Pennsylvania, unfortunately, leads the nation now in the cases of Lyme disease.
Well, and your perseverance does not go unnoticed, and that's the one thing that patients and families, they need as well, to really just fight and to get better. But I wanted to ask you specifically, with your involvement legislatively, can you kind of walk us through your involvement in helping to address Lyme disease here in Pennsylvania?
Thank you. Well, I've been an advocate for over many years for greater public awareness of the dangers of the Lyme disease. We don't have, we can't afford not to be able to let people know what the symptoms are so that they can protect themselves, both without, so they don't get Lyme disease, and if they do get Lyme disease, that they have that they know what to do and how to identify the signs. I first offered a bill on this matter in 1988, which would provide for general public information and education regarding Lyme disease. The measure was introduced as a result of increasing occurrences of Lyme disease in my legislative district, which includes Montgomery and Bucks counties, and it's a hot spot for the disease now. I also had a family member who contracted the disease, and the only way we knew him, he was my youngest son, and the only way that we knew that he had Lyme disease, that he had a circle, concentric circles on his back. Unfortunately, that doesn't always happen with everybody, but if you do have that, you have Lyme disease, and you should seek attention and treatment immediately. I continue to introduce Lyme disease legislation every session thereafter, and in 2009, I met Julia Wagner, who's the co-founder of Pennsylvania Lyme and a constituent, and several other families in my district about Lyme legislation. They shared their stories about Lyme disease and expressed interest and support for amending my existing bill or introducing a separate new bill that was more comprehensive to address the problem. The bill had three components. The first is establish a task force for public education, require insurance coverage, physicians, and having the right to diagnose and treat based on clinical judgment, and protect health care providers from professional misconduct proceedings solely for the prescription of long-term antibiotics. We had to stop that, to stop the medical profession from intimidating other physicians in introducing, treating, and providing antibiotics. There is such a thing as chronic Lyme disease. People have died from it. In 2010, the Senate Banking Insurance Committee held a public hearing on the bill, and in 2012, we reached a compromise with interested parties, which removed the physician protection and mandatory insurance coverage provisions of the bill, but maintained the task force public education piece of the original bill. Unfortunately, the bill stalled and did not pass in the 2011-2012. Finally, in 2014, the General Assembly approved it by legislation, Senate Bill 177, Act 83, establishing a 20-member task force on Lyme disease comprised of various officials, physicians, nurses, as well as individuals impacted by Lyme disease. The task force was charged with investigating and making recommendations for the department regarding, one, the surveillance and prevention of Lyme disease and related tick-borne illnesses in the Commonwealth, raising awareness about the long-term effects of the misdiagnosis of Lyme disease, and development of a program of general public health care, special information, and education regarding Lyme disease. I would prefer to see the entire bill remain intact, but this is what we were able to get passed in the legislature at this time. But we haven't given up. This is all in regard to Act 23 now, 83, I'm sorry, of the task force convened in September 2014 and issues its final report in September 2015. The task force made a number of recommendations, 16 in all, to the department regarding education, awareness, prevention, and surveillance. They included developing a publicly accessible website, which contains tick-borne disease, surveillance data, as well as implementing a statewide education and awareness program. So that's basically the background of this legislation and the process of going through the state legislature.
You know, I think, speaking on behalf of the Lyme community, I think the majority agreed. The way that you went about it to get something, education, prevention, surveillance, it seemed like getting something was better than nothing. And I know that just this past October, the task force with the Health and Human Services, they talked about more about Act 83 and certainly what's going on in the funding and just the progress. And if I could ask you, I am interested, kind of where do we stand with regard to implementing the recommendations of the Act 83 Task Force?
Okay, well, the Pennsylvania Health Department is attempting to carry out improved awareness and education with the limited funds or federal dollars that they have. The department indicated that between October 2015 and September 2018, Lyme disease awareness and primary prevention education programs were held in various counties. They were trying to implement the Act 83 task force recommendations. And to their credit, they're doing as best as they can with the limit, as I said, the limited dollars that they have. In October 2016, Pennsylvania Lyme began developing, planning, and implementing a new community prevention and education program called Dare to Be Tick Aware. It's my understanding that there are 55 events, workshops booked this year on the prevention and education. Shortly after the adoption of the report, the Health Department asked the Legislative Budget and Finance Committee to conduct an analysis of all the recommendations to determine the total cost of implementation. And this is a high figure. The minimum or low-cost approach to carry out all the recommendations highlighted in the report was estimated at a cost of $23.6 million. The maximum reasonable effort to carry out all the recommendations could cost up to $115 million. A lot of money, and we're not going to do it all at one time, but we have to just keep at this, educating and the public in Pennsylvania. Unfortunately, Pennsylvania has got one of the highest incurrence rate of Lyme than any other state. Used to be the New England states and Connecticut, but that's not the case anymore. We do have a significant incurrence of this disease. It's an epidemic, actually, and we need to let the public know about it.
Well, it certainly is an epidemic. In Pennsylvania, as you said, for the last 6 years in a row, we've been the number one state And, you know, to have been the number one state for that many years without any legislative efforts, it was just very, very frustrating for those of us that are working towards certainly kind of treatment options. We've always said that, you know, you don't see billboards, you don't see PSA announcements, you don't see any kind of governmental warnings or anything. And it was really very vexing for us. But I know that it appears at least that is kind of changing. Maybe you could touch on what efforts, to your knowledge, are being made to allocate some of those funds and resources to implementing those recommendations.
Thank you. I'll try. We have to recognize the costs associated with implementing Act 85 and the recommendations, and the fact that we did not allocate any state dollars to combat Lyme disease. For the past 2 years, I've communicated with the health secretary and the governor and asked if they propose adding state funding to their budget to help begin to implement the task force recommendations. I'm pleased to say that Governor Wolf recently unveiled his proposed budget for the next year, 2018-2019, and recommends $2.5 million to the department to help implement the task force recommendations. This is first time in the history of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania that money has been earmarked specifically to deal with the epidemic that Pennsylvania is facing. The Senate and the House Appropriations Committees are currently holding hearings and to examine the governor's budget proposals and to speak with agency heads. I am a member of that committee, and I would urge individuals to contact their state senators and House members and ask that they maintain the governor's proposed funding for Lyme disease in the final budget to be adopted by the General Assembly by the end of June, and communicate that support with their leadership. We need to take action. In the last 6 years, Pennsylvania ranked, as I indicated, highest in the country in the number of confirmed cases of Lyme disease. Further, a 2015 Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection study was published confirming a high risk of Lyme disease in every county of the Commonwealth, as 67 counties had the black-legged tick, verifying that every Pennsylvanian from Philadelphia to Erie must take precautions to prevent the spread of Lyme disease. We are in the middle of an epidemic, and we need to let the people of Pennsylvania know that, and to show them how to protect themselves and to treat and obtain treatment.
Definitely. Thank you very much for that, Senator. One last question for you. Could you share about your other bill on Lyme disease as it relates to insurance coverage, please?
Yes. I have reintroduced legislation this session, Senate Bill 100, which would put into the law the remaining two pieces that were removed from my original bill. One component of Senate Bill 100 requires insurance coverage for Lyme disease. Three states, Massachusetts, Connecticut, and Rhode Island, have now enacted laws that require insurance coverage for long-term antibiotic treatment of Lyme disease. The second component gives healthcare professionals the right to diagnose and prescribe antibiotic therapy for the patient upon making a clinical diagnosis of Lyme disease. Also, no healthcare professionals would be subject to disciplinary action by their licensing board solely for prescribing longer-term antibiotic therapies for a patient with Lyme disease. Seven states, again, Rhode Island, New York, Minnesota, Connecticut, Massachusetts, New Jersey, and Vermont have approved similar language. And Senate Bill 100 will enable licensed physicians to make treatment decisions based upon their best clinical judgment without interference from third-party insurers. Senate Bill 100 is currently in the Senate Banking Insurance Committee, chaired by Senator Don White, and I've communicated support for committee consideration of the bill, and I know Pennsylvania Lyme has been educating legislators about the need for the legislation and help them understand that there is a chronic Lyme disease problem. That said, I would urge that those in support of the bill to contact their state senator and ask them to contact Senator White and request that he as committee chair, move the bill out of committee for consideration. We have no time to waste here. People are contracting this disease, and as I said, dying from it, and we need to take these steps now.
I certainly second your emotion there and the strength of your conviction. I know persistence is what it took to get the original Senate Bill 177 to legislation Act 83. We wish you Godspeed that you can do it sooner than that. So really want to thank you very much for all your efforts on behalf of the Lyme community.
Well, thank you for joining me and putting this issue as a priority and educating the public in our state.
And thank you. You know, what Senator Greenleaf says, which is really the strength of the support groups and the support group you're going to be starting, it's grassroots. When you look at legislation, it takes grassroots efforts to get things done. So having a support group, having knowledgeable individuals in your community, and for anyone that is watching or listening to this, do call Senator Don White. Ask him to get Senate Bill 100 out of committee. It really deserves the attention of everyone. Right now in the state of Pennsylvania, there's some fear that doctors could be reprimanded, they could be held up for treating inappropriately, and Senate Bill 100 would do away with that. It's a doctor protection type of a legislation, as well insurance reimbursement. Because of the way, and this is a bit of the controversy, because of the way the disease is written up, the Infectious Disease Society of America is the academic medical body that really comes up with guidelines for infectious disease. They come up with guidelines what Lyme is, what it is not, how to treat it. And their guidelines have really been, we believe, a little bit behind the science for a while now. It's those guidelines that say that a doctor should only be prescribing 2 to 3 weeks of antibiotics. It's those guidelines that say there's no such thing as chronic Lyme if somebody has symptoms afterwards. Because of those guidelines and because of the way that they were written, insurance companies will use those to deny insurance claims. So what Senator Greenleaf was saying is so vitally important, that we need to have legislation in Pennsylvania that doctors can feel free and protected to treat accordingly. It is a clinical diagnosis. What a lot of people may not understand right now is Act 83, really, it is law that there are two schools of thought. So there's the IDSA school of thought for Lyme disease, but there's also the ILADS. So there really are two guidelines in the state of Pennsylvania. So if you're listening or watching this and you're going to a doctor who says, no, I can only treat you one way, that's no longer accurate. You want to look at the legislation of Act 83. So with that, we do want to thank Senator Greenleaf again. We're getting to an interesting portion of this presentation, and this is going to go into some slides, some infographics. And I know that if we could go to the slides, please. The way that this was written up was Lyme disease in America. I almost feel half bad about that, that it really should be also Lyme disease in Pennsylvania. What Senator Greenleaf said is absolutely accurate. Pennsylvania, the worst state for the last 6 years in a row, the highest incidence of Lyme disease the last 6 years in a row. And because of that, his role of getting legislation through is so very, very important. But as we were putting this together, what we recognize is that if you're part of the advocacy, if you're part of the individuals that have been paying attention, it's really easy to understand the scope of the epidemic. As it says on the slide, the unspoken epidemic, it is an epidemic. It is in every state in America, and it's in every county in Pennsylvania. There was a survey that was done and a study that was done by LymeDisease.org in 2015. A lot of the content, which we're going to share with you now, is based on some of the studies. Lyme disease is the fastest growing disease per the Center for Disease Control. You can see each year it's approximately 300,000 people that get contracted with Lyme disease. You'll notice on the slide that is more than breast cancer and HIV combined. We believe that that number is low. It actually at one time was only deemed to be 30,000, but the CDC recently came out and said it's probably 10 times greater than that. If you'll notice on this map, look at the incidence of Lyme in 2001. This is based on the CDC. These are reported cases as reported to the CDC. My personal belief is there's probably 20, 50 cases for every one that goes reported. So I think that this is probably very much so underreported. But just with reported cases, look at where it stands in 2015, where you can see all of Pennsylvania is now in a particular area of an epidemic state. Every county in Pennsylvania, as Senator Greenleaf said. As we said earlier, the CDC increased it. They said for years, for a decade, I was under the impression that they were using 30,000 diagnosed cases a year. They came out a handful of years ago and said, because of the poor testing, because of the poor diagnosis, because of just kind of the cracks in the system, it's probably 10 times that. So you can see 300,000, 5,700 cases a week, 822 cases per day. That is in America. 40% of all Lyme cases last year, 2016 is the last year that we have reporting data, were here in Pennsylvania. You're going to see that the risk is actually hidden. What you see on this slide is on the left-hand side, 50% of the people that contract Lyme never remember seeing a tick. In the middle, 50% of the people never remember seeing a rash. And on the right, that shows 35% got a negative blood test. I've seen it as actually being much higher. We use an expression 50-50-50. Somebody never saw a tick, they never saw a rash, they had all the symptoms, they went to their doctor, the test came back negative, and now what do you do? Doctor says, I don't have it, but they're still getting ill. Now they're on the treadmill to try to get better. If you look at this slide here, you see failure rates. Multiple studies show that the percentage of false negatives average around 50%. Literally, it's the flip of a coin. So if anybody's listening or watching this show, if you came back and the doctor said, nope, it came back negative, you want to find another doctor. You want to find a Lyme literate medical doctor. Go to palyme.org and we can help you find a doctor in Pennsylvania because the tests are seriously flawed. This is a little disturbing. If you look at the time it took to get a proper diagnosis, what you're going to notice is the largest band there to the right in purple, more than 2 years. I think the average number of doctors that a Lyme patient has seen before they've gotten a proper diagnosis of Lyme, it's in between about 6 to 12 doctors, very, very common that people spend a lot of time trying to get a proper diagnosis. One of the reasons of people then, they do get a proper diagnosis, but their doctor says, well, the guidelines say I'm going to give you 2 to 3 weeks, 4 weeks of doxycycline is most commonly, could be amoxicycline if it's a child, antibiotic, but it's a short-term course. The slide that's on the screen really shows that the standard antibiotic short course regimen has a very high failure rate. I believe it's very common that when people take antibiotics and then maybe 6 months later they'll have a flare-up, 12 months later they'll have a flare-up. It just kind of keeps coming back, and there's reasons for that which we may not have an opportunity to get into for this particular presentation. But what you notice on the slide here is people get very sick from Lyme. 40% have long-term problems. So the people that answered this survey, 40% of them said ongoing, chronic, persistent, long-term, 4 out of 10 people still had symptoms. In the middle, 40% had a relapse after taking antibiotics. A lot of people, and I did initially too, I took my first 3 weeks of antibiotics and I thought, well, I'm cured, until I got so sick and sick afterwards. On the right-hand side, 60% of the people, long-term, joint pain, arthritis pain, they have symptoms of joint swelling. It just simply, for some people, is chronic and simply does not go away. This is a pretty disturbing slide that shows, look at those participants who said that their symptoms after their initial round of treatment, that 59% still had fatigue, 50% sleep impairment, muscle pain, joint pain, depression, memory loss, that the long-term chronic nature of Lyme is such that 20 to 40% of people have ongoing symptoms. And you don't have to live with that. There's actually things that you can do, and we encourage people to be an advocate for their own care. They have to go to a support group. They have to plug in. They have to find another doctor to be an advocate. You're going to see that Lyme is a multi-systematic disease. It affects the nervous system, the blood, the circulatory system, organs, the brains, the joints, muscle, skin. On the left-hand side, it affects everything. You'll notice on the right, early stage Lyme presents itself with a lot of symptoms. Chronic Lyme also presents with a lot of the symptoms, but it simply keeps getting worse. Impact to quality of life. When I saw this slide, it really impressed upon me how much hurting people with Lyme are actually doing. 73% of the participants said that their quality of life was poor, was fair or poor, or very low quality of life, which is more than congestive heart failure, fibromyalgia, multiple sclerosis. It scored higher than a lot of the other diseases. What I find fascinating, not a lot of people know this. They know someone, oh, he had Lyme, took doxy, and he's now fine. They don't know that there's people that are just simply not participating in life, staying at home because Lyme has taken a significant amount away from them. Not only health, but financially. 42% stopped working out of, you know, the average workforce of 6%. So of the people that responded to this particular survey, 42% stopped working. The damage that does to their employers, to the system, to just really the economy, Lyme really has tentacles that go very, very far, and you can see a lot of people that took reduced hours. It's very common for people to go on disability. Unfortunately, it's also common for people to not actually be able to get disability payments because it's a denied claim. Children are impacted the most, I would say. 25% of most cases are children between the ages of 5 to 14. In Pennsylvania, if 300,000 cases a year in America, if we get 40% of them, there's 120,000 people in Pennsylvania each year that get Lyme disease, 25% are children. 30,000 children a year, 2,500 a month, 83 children a day. If you run the numbers, if 20 to 40% of them are chronic, as many as 30 children a day are getting long-term symptoms. And their symptoms can be neurological, it can be attention deficit, it can be changing personality, autistic types of symptoms. It really is terrible for children. In Pennsylvania, it's not just the deer tick. There are 4 other ticks that are carrying a significant amount of diseases. I'm going to cut to really just prevention. If you suspect you're in an area that has a lot of ticks, you want to avoid that area, dress defensively, you want to remove ticks, do a tick check daily, and just be aware of some of the symptoms. As I'm going through, the way to remove a tick is really just by gently nudging it out with tweezers. This is online at Pennsylvania Lyme. Call to action. What can you do? There is a medical conference April 6th and 7th at the Hershey Lodge. So the call to action is, if you have a doctor that needs to get educated, direct them to the iLadge website for the conference on the 6th and the 7th. And I want to close, Ann, really kind of turning it over to you. You came out of the woodwork, and you know, thank God for your willingness to say what you went through. You don't want anyone else to go through. So with this particular meeting that you're going to have, you're going to be holding this on a regular monthly frequency, correct?
Correct. The third Wednesday of every month from 6 to 8 p.m. at Atonement. Again, the first one will be coming 3-2-1. If you can remember that, I know for people with Lyme, sometimes it's hard to remember things. So 3-2-1, it's as easy as that. But I just felt that this was something super duper important to bring into this community. This was a very harrowing experience that I endured mostly on my own, which was partly my own stubbornness to not share this with people, but I really didn't even know what was wrong with me. So very important.
Yeah, you're going to be touching a lot of lives. You're going to be creating an environment for people to come and share and learn, and that's a pretty powerful thing. So I want to thank you very much for stepping into the fray. We're very pleased to have you.
Thank you, Eric. Yeah. And I appreciate your support and all you've done too.
Because yeah, we're all in this together.
That's right.
We have a debt to everyone.
That's right.
So with that, I want to wrap it up. This was very productive. First time I've ever done this. I don't know. You're a pro at this. You're a veteran at this, right?
I've been on here a few times. There's some other issues that I feel very passionate about, but yeah.
I shared this with you that I actually thought I was showing up to be interviewed for 4 minutes and found out not too long ago, no, we have a whole hour that we've got to put together. So for the first go around, I think we did a good job.
Yes.
If there's a future opportunity, I think we can just keep carrying this message to the local community. And again, thank you for everything.
Yes.
So I want to direct everyone to PALyme.org, nonprofit organization, no paid staff. We are in business to support you and to support the support groups. So go to PALyme for information. And thank you very much.